I have a couple of announcements. One is that tonight's lecture was originally scheduled for March 20th. Jeff Kipnis, who was originally scheduled for tonight, will lecture on March 20th. There are two other special lectures that are going to happen in March. One is Monday, March 18th, Peter Cook will be here. And on Friday, March 29th, Office DA from Cambridge, Monica Ponce-de-Leon and Nader Tehrani will be here. Both of those lectures are at 7. So March 18th, Peter Cook, March 29th, Office DA from Cambridge. That's all I have to say. Eric.
Good evening. Welcome to SciArc. It's a pleasure to introduce, can't quite see him over there, but I assume he hasn't left the room. It's a pleasure to introduce Jesse Reiser. As some of you know, an increasingly well-known progenitor of substantial intellectual mischief in the long tradition that SciArc continues to support. How much mischief and how much intellect we will soon hear. I've looked at the work, as you have, with some care. And as we were discussing a moment ago, there are at least two strands that I've distinguished. You're welcome to concur or not. One which reflects an aspiration to build and to construct, which seems to carry with it a language, a vocabulary that is somewhat more recognizable. And the other with what I would call an aspiration to advocate a particular position in the profession. And what I'm looking for is the intersection of those two strands. Language and the relationship of language, of verbalization to work done is a significant point here. And in reading a series of interviews that Jesse did, and looking at what has come to be a somewhat predictable lexicon of fluid and dynamic and evolving, and how those words are rendered in a medium which physiologically, at least, is essentially static. So another issue or a question we ought to ask or to look for is the relationship of that language to shape and form in space. In general terms, in the long history of and discussion of ideas, among many tendencies, there are two that might be worth noting. Over long periods of time, the inclination to complexity and concomitant reverse inclination to simplicity. And I think a question from me for Jesse, and maybe for all of us, is to what extent the work ratifies a predilection towards spatial intricacy. In other words, is Jesse Reiser Columbus looking for India and landing in America on his first voyage? Or is he Columbus who already knows his destination on his second voyage, goes looking for America and finds it? Let's find out.
Thank you, Eric, for that introduction. I must say that I'm not sure if I'd be able to supply that answer this evening. It's one of those things that in one's own work and in one's own experience, sometimes it's right in front of you and you don't really know yourself. So in any case, I want to just say that I'm glad to be back at SciArc. I've given two lectures here two years ago. And the last one I gave began by my reading of a polemical statement. I'm not going to do that this evening. I'm simply going to show projects. The reason being that in the past 2 years, I feel as if we in the office basically kind of hold ourselves up and just continue to generate work, both in competition and then in a couple of instances here that I'll be showing, work that is headed towards building. I would want to also simply comment on, I guess some of my fellows aren't here tonight, Carl Chu and of course Marcelo and Hernan, whom I know very well, that their work is tremendously important to this school, to the life of the school, and generally, though, all of those who are pursuing more radical forms of experimentation, I think that it's really important, and I'm really kind of happy that Eric has embraced those three. I'm sure there are others whom I don't know, but I would just want to make that comment, and I hope that that direction of work really has a future in the school. It's tremendously important, and it shouldn't be left as a kind of a sideline or something that would be marginalized. It should be really pursued towards its final end, which to my mind would also intersect with the realm of a building. Well, anyway, I want to present six projects tonight. The first being our proposal, our competition work for BMW, not the last competition, which we just came out of a week ago for a factory in Leipzig, but there was also a competition held this past spring for an event and delivery center in Munich, showing that. And then another competition, an invitational competition for a children's museum in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Then a commission for a small office building in Sarasota, Florida, which is right now kind of gone through its zoning approvals and will hopefully begin construction at the end of the year. Yet again, a kind of an associated project which won't be built, a competition for the AIA headquarters in New York, which we were finalists in. And then a project which actually Eric is part of as well, houses at Sagaponic, showing that. And that, we are told, should also begin towards the end of this year. And then finally, a competition held by the I-Beam Atelier in New York for a museum of art and technology. So I'm going to just jump right in and begin.
Can we get the slides, please? Okay, this was a competition that was, we reached the second stage in. It was held by BMW to develop an event and delivery center. What that is actually a place where one would pick up their new BMW automobile, outfit it, and essentially immerse oneself in what they call BMW culture. It was heavily kind of supported, not entirely, well, yes, by the company, but the public relations aspect side of BMW had a tremendous influence, naturally, on the structure of this competition and also the outcome of the competition, which is finally one by Wolf Cricks. For us, it was a very interesting kind of problem because, in a sense, the Event and Delivery Center falls into that peculiar scale of building that's neither just kind of an object building nor a piece of urbanism, but somewhere larger than a building but smaller than, say, a neighborhood in a city. And because it's so much involved the automobile, it also naturally would incorporate an infrastructural component. So one of the main features of this building as part of the brief was the creation of what they call a lap of honor, basically a loop that would be kind of a roadway, which we interpreted as almost a kind of racetrack inside the building, that one would basically pick up their automobile, drive the lap of honor, and then exit the building. And so it became a kind of a major sort of formal and organizational element to the building. In addition to that, the context for the building, which is in Munich, was kind of directly located adjacent to both the BMW factory that you see here, which supplies some of the automobiles that go into the Event and Delivery Center, not all, but some of them, as well as the Olympic Park, which actually would be in the foreground. Crowds would come from mainly soccer games, which are held at the Olympic Park now, pass by this site, and then finally enter into a subway here. So one of the main sort of imperatives in the brief was to catch the flow of visitors in and out of the subway to kind of move them into the Event and Delivery Center. And so it was kind of a coiled project, kind of two vortices, one of which would incorporate a land bridge into the project, and then a second, which is the coil of the track itself, finally emerges and dumps you out into the adjoining neighborhood. As I said, the project, in a certain sense, was a continuation for us of some of the logics that we were playing around with for a planning scale project for the east side of New York, where we looked at the relationship between different systems of roads and territories along the water's edge, and deliberately tried to create a kind of intensive urbanism, by which, what I mean by that is that we looked at particular interchanges between high-speed and medium-speed roads and local roads, and the kinds of territories and programming that could be involved with those changes of speed and volume of the road and the context, how the context corresponds with that. Here again is a, kind of an image of the Event and Delivery Center in relation to the factory, the Olympic Park you see here, and then an edge of the kind of beginning really of the fabric of Munich, kind of what's once really a kind of an edge condition to the city, now really more incorporated to the center of the city, but there's still this large green space that the Event and Delivery Center would involve. So, as I was mentioning earlier, this the diagram on the left, which actually comes from the kind of the architectural study guide pre-computer, and they go over the kind of the standard hierarchy of speed and programming from an interchange down to local streets, and you can see the kind of connection between the arterial street, which comes off of the interchange, its connection to collector streets and commercial programming, and then down in scale, finally, to residential streets small-scale streets with residential programming. We were trying to find a kind of systemic analog to that in the project, where we would be able to kind of look at the affiliations between this looping road, and then a whole series of scales of programs and systems in the building. So at the lowest most level, tied to actually the deliveries and the streets, are the storage areas for cars that come out of the factory, which are then stored. They're then elevated up to a next level, and through a series of processes are prepared for the owner, and then finally raised up to this level on a series of turntables, which are then the place where they come off the turntable, get connected, rolled into a ramp. The owner is united with his new car at that point, and there begins this lap of honor. So the cycle of this building was basically to deliver a BMW to its owner with angels, with their, keys on cushion every 2 minutes. People would make their lap of honor and then go. Of course, they wanted also the population, the people to get their cars to use this space, to before they received the car, they would actually be able to customize it, look at the history of BMW, be given lectures and so forth. So this is essentially the space which relates to reception. This is the space that basically has to do with presentation. There's a large theater space in the center, and then it's ringed by commercial space. So in a sense, it is a kind of a city within the city. It has its own sort of places for entertainment and for eating and shopping, and all of those functions are kind of folded up into this double vortex. So we were very interested also in looking at, again, at some of the issues from the East Side Project that we did, the linear planning project, and seeing how they might be rescaled and applied to the event and delivery center. One of the kind of formal interests and devices had to do with the issue of an automobile kind of running in the building, how we would deal with the topology of this track, which initially was simply developed as a road. So one kind of picked their car up here, entered into the track. There was a kind of coil, kind of slow speed space here. One could go up a mild incline, begin to really move more quickly, hit bank corners, go into the straightaway, and either kind of peel back and do another loop, or at this point connect into the exit road. And so given that sort of series of speeds and the sort of byproducts of noise and so forth, and visibility, we came up with the idea of dealing with a kind of partially, like a slit tube that could be peeled in two directions. In this case, that tube would enclose the roadway, and one would be able to view to the outside on this side of the tube at the high-speed area. The tube would then flip back and form the bank, be part of the banked curve, and it would then be at the car would be at a slower speed, and it would be then visible from the inside. So at the two extreme ends, one would be able to see the car mainly from the inside of the space. Along the long face of the building, one would be able to view the car from the outside. And then there would be a kind of corresponding deposition of programming below these spaces related to how the surface of the enclosure was folded. And finally, another element in the design had to do with the development of the surface of the roadways and the roof, which was not a simple matter. We were interested, again, in looking at the development of a space frame that would accomplish this. I just included this. This was actually not an image that inspired us, but it happened that the double helix, the double vortex, seemed to correspond very closely to an image of one that we found, but actually it was found later. But in any case, there was a very deliberate attempt to look at the shift of materials as well, from the kind of grass ramp that connects pedestrian movement from the Olympic Park into a series of programs of restaurants and so forth that would take you down to the reception area of the project. And then also on this side of the project, kind of to take that surface, have that pull through to become a kind of central reception zone in the slow kind of speed spiral in the center here. And then finally have it develop as the surface of the event space on this side of the project. As I mentioned before, we had been experimenting with the notion of using a space frame that could basically be understood not as a kind of homogeneous and uniform system for producing long spans, which it could still do, of course, but that there would be a possibility of modulating it such that at its most extreme moments, it would actually cease to be a space frame. It would kind of reach such a level of density that the kind of cross members would fall away. You'd get a more kind of conventional two-way system when this system was really kind of pulled and elongated. And then as it stretched out to develop the larger spans, then it would incrementally begin to develop its characteristic as a space frame. It was literally developed as a kind of fabric and used on the bias, the way the fabric kind of assumes flexibility on the bias. It was actually utilized this way. We worked with Ove Arup, with Cecil Bauman and Charles Walker on this, and then there was also a space frame company called Miro, which is a very large space frame manufacturer in Germany, who are one of the only companies who can really not only kind of have the technology to deal with continuous variation in the space frame, they also have the sort of techniques of being able to construct it such that you have whatever, you know, probably 10,000 nodes, each of which are unique, and they have to arrive on the building site in the at the right time and in the right place. So they use a parcel tracking software. They actually barcode every single element of a space frame like this, and those elements are then delivered. They're milled, of course, uniquely, and then they're delivered to exactly the right spot at exactly the right time. And that really would be part of not only of, you know, the kind of the formal and organizational issue of design, but also how one would actually kind of put this kind of thing together without going completely, you know, mad. And so they've rationalized that form of delivery and construction of it as well. Here, just another view of the space frame, as I said, the more extreme moments. And of course, this was developed at the level of competition. Obviously, there would have to be much further development relative to looking at actually how one would analyze each node, the angle of drilling, the length of the strut, and so forth. But it was at the kind of level of development of geometry in the competition, this was where we sort of left it. And further, we were interested in, there were certain areas within this where the span actually became just too great, even, you know, for the space frame. So a series of columns, which actually had a more kind of geodesic character, were modeled and modeled into that matrix and then emerged and support the larger kind of span zones in the project. So this model, which utilizes window screen, was as close an approximation that we could make in the time given to do it. But it was actually quite close, and we were actually literally using that kind of grid on the bias to achieve those volumes. Here, a sectional, long sectional view of the project. You can see the kind of large-scale storage space below, which, if I remember correctly, had the capacity to hold something like 400 cars, and they would be continuously brought into this as two car per hour formula. There would be constant replenishment of the automobiles. That intermediate level where cars were brought through the kind of preparation process, and then finally at the main level, the delivery of the car. And then on this side, you can kind of see a section of the of the theater space and the commercial spaces that wrap the building. And you can see here the model image isn't that sharp, but the cars on the turntables. Again, you know, some of the elements that were required, like the turntables, were not of our design, but more or less required by the brief. And it was our sort of job then to somehow make them kind of correlate to the system we were working with. But there was always a kind of a difficulty, in a sense, in making what the desires of the public relations people at BMW were interested in having as part of the event with our conception of how the building would work and how cars would be picked up. So you can see here in plan the land bridge and how it kind of moves down and into the project. You get very interesting kind of interstitial spaces as well, these kind of web spaces where you'd be dealing with the development of structure above and below, and those became areas of kind of major programming like restaurants and so forth. And then also the kind of development of the bridge strand, which is emerging out of the automobile loop and its kind of point of delivery back into the city. So those are the two kind of organizing forces. Okay, I'm going to jump down in scale. This was the Children's Museum of Pittsburgh, limited competition that we are finalists in. And it's part of the redevelopment of Allegheny Center, which is not on the main center of Pittsburgh, but across the Allegheny River, adjacent to the central area. The square was really dominated by, you know, the large-scale commercial space and mall. An existing children's museum housed in this small neoclassical building. A planetarium that has been derelict for the past 15 years because of the presence of asbestos and so forth. Also the fact that the neighborhood had become fairly run down, so there was less interest in abatement and fixing the building up. So it became an element that was offered by the city to the Children's Museum, and that could be, if, in the competition, incorporated into the new proposal for the Children's Museum. So our idea, rather than making a kind of ground-based extension, was to essentially build the beginnings of a bridge. Actually, it was a more of a planning move because there had been discussion about dealing with the development of elevated walkways off the site, and that this would be, in essence, the kind of endpoint of an extended planning system, and the Children's Museum would be incorporated into that. So it became an elevated bar that crossed along one edge of this plaza here. There was also a fountain, a kind of an urban amenity, they said, from the 60s that existed on this site. We were also given the task to redesign that plaza. So one of the issues was how we would bring a landscape development into the Children's Museum building as well. So an elevated bar, an included landscape, and then the question of how we would deal with a fairly complex series of programmatic spaces within the bar and have them become connected in ways that wouldn't simply stratify the bar. So our concept was to begin to weave together both spatially and structurally the levels of the bar, that there would be a kind of lattice truss, a table, you know, lattice truss surrounding the bar itself, and then each of the slabs would be a kind of rigid steel grillage, and from that grillage, these structural elements would come down and meet the adjacent slab elements. The idea, too, was that these could also serve as ways of moving between spaces as well. So that became a kind of matrix within which we worked spatially within the bar. And then there was a question of how we would actually connect to the two adjoining buildings. What we did was basically make the Children's Museum, the existing Children's Museum, a kind of entrance for the bridge. One would actually move into that neoclassical space, pass through the some major exhibitions in that centralized space, and then up into the bar. And there would also be connections to the planetarium. These are the spaces that we were conceiving of occupying within the planetarium. More classroom-like spaces, actually, which is part of the educational function of the building. And then our strategy actually was not to touch the planetarium dome. That would actually be, because of various economic factors, better leased out. So we deliberately didn't make proposals for that space and put all our energies into the development of the bar. So, focus the right. One of our interests as well was to not understand any of these slabs within the bar as being more or less monolithic, but that we could run a finer scale of organization through the surfaces and thereby allow a different kind of transparency. I put this slide up on the right. It's actually one of the images of the water garden that we designed with Jeffrey Kipnis, because it served as a kind of basis, in a way, for further experimentation, not in this case with a grooved concrete system, but with looking at how we could begin to develop a flexible louver system that could be, through a series of different rotations, begin to develop different densities of openness or closedness. So in this case, the louver system from one side of the building would appear extremely open, but then from the other side, if you looked at it, these zones, for example, are twisted 180 degrees. They would become more or less, here they're more or less opaque in the field. If you were to move to the other side, the entire roof would be opaque, and there's a rendering that shows that. And those zones would be open. So it became a way of modulating areas of light within the space. And further, you can see on a larger scale a similar notion of weaving happening in the ramps that also are structuring the space itself. So the idea of a kind of interpenetration created by different scales of modulation, variable modulation in the space, is really important. I should also say that the spaces weren't really very determined in terms of the program. They're idea was to leave the spaces fairly open in terms of what they might want to mount in this museum. There were a series of zones. Here in these blue enclosures, which were more sort of formalized group play and education spaces. But for the most part, the spaces were left fairly open. And one of their interests was to bring what they call real stuff into the museum, which is to say that they wanted the children to be able to look at, say, how a car is serviced, or how a landscape might be tended. Anything that would be sort of the occupation of grown-ups could somehow be brought into the museum at a fairly large and realistic scale, and not simply be a static exhibit, but something that the children would really engage directly. So these are some of the suggestions about the real stuff spaces here. Growing space within the building, and use of the modulation of light. This is what I talked about earlier, this possibility of being able, through some fairly simple methods of the kind of twist of the panels, to create these varying densities of light in the space. And here, the kind of sense of in the central space, being able to look and have a kind of transparency through the entire building. And also, and I'm not sure how far this would go, but the idea that one could also move on these, and we could actually slide down these structural elements, become a kind of slides that move from one space to another. So here is the kind of overall view of the bar, connection to the landscape below, and again, the connection both to the planetarium building here and the existing children's museum here. Okay, this is, I only have a few slides of this. This is, as I mentioned earlier, a commission that we received about a year ago to develop a small-scale office building on a site in the city of Sarasota, Florida. It's an interesting problem, even because of some fairly banal issues, but of parking in the city. That the owner of the building would have to supply 175 spaces of parking for her employees, and they couldn't be on the city streets. It would be simply impossible. So one of the immediate requirements was to create a parking structure, and that parking structure would then serve as a kind of base for whatever development would happen over it. Now, normally, to make a project like this happen, one would typically, increase the number of parking spaces and hence the number of parking slabs, and then develop a tower over this over this site. But because the owner wanted complete control of the project, she deliberately had us underbuild it, which actually meant that, at least to a certain extent, given her limited budget, the architectural quality would have a tendency to be higher. Although from the economic point of view, the bankers were just shaking their heads because she, by right, could have gone up 12 stories at least. In any case, it was a fairly simple program, and what we were very interested in doing was somehow trying to find that kind of peculiar connection between the parking garage and the building above, and also given the constraints budgetarily, the necessity of kind of holding in check our predilection for
greater formal elaboration. So we began by developing some kind of rough models which dealt with a kind of double spiral, which allowed for people, when they park in the parking structure, to kind of move up in the spiral system. And then there would be a series of offices arrayed about the spiral, and finally how that spiral would enter into this plan, which is kind of roughly square in plan. And so finally the spiral would terminate into the staircase, and then a series of executive offices, as you see here. And these areas would be field of smaller offices. What this company does is they supply software to the healthcare industry, and they also train people to use that software in the building itself. So part of the requirement of the building were training rooms and, of course, fairly elaborate computer rooms as well. So this is the kind of development. Again, you know, we couldn't use we had to kind of go back to fairly conventional ways of structuring the project, the column grid, for example, and fairly standardized framing in this project. But you can see the kind of development from the spiral to the kind of to the floor plate, and then ultimately to an open plan in the roof. And there were further plans that elaborate an intermediate level, which is not shown in the model, between this main floor plate. And the roof. Okay, so this project on the left, again, the building assembled. Project on the right is kind of a sister project. It was a competition, though, for the AIA headquarters in New York. Again, with a fairly low budget, and also with a space that was already sort of fairly determined in terms of what one could do. This is a space on LaGuardia Place, which is presently a store that they want to basically gut and acquire the main level, which is shown here, and then two floors below that, both of them basement floors. The idea was to find a way of bringing light into those spaces, deal with the existing slabs and structure, and we dealt with Guy Nordenson on this project, and basically came up with the idea of perforating, kind of heavily perforating the upper floor slab to go basically anywhere where you wouldn't find beams. And in larger areas, create open wells, and smaller areas to kind of create glazed openings that would begin to bring light down into these lower spaces. This intermediate level incorporated bar and a library space and study spaces, and then finally at the lowest most level, lecture spaces. So here's the overall section assembled, the perforated slab. A helical stair, glass stair, which wouldn't need any intermediate supports, basically would deal with all of its reactions along the surface and bring the loads down. That was one of these main contributions in the project. And it would also be a programmed stair, that there would be information and terminals along this stair that one could utilize for part of an extension of the library for various information and resources. And then finally, down at the bottom, it would frame the lecture hall. So the project, because again it had a limited budget, was going to be phased. And the idea was that in the first phase, one would simply occupy the street level of the project. And in the second stage, this major well would be opened, and then the stair developed to bring it down to the lower levels. We were also, again, dealing with ways that we could create
certain sculptural walls in the space, again, rather inexpensively. And we developed a system and a series of healthcare offices that we had designed using drywall and ruled surfaces. So you can see those walls here. That meant kind of dealing with splicing together, basically, two systems of ruled surfaces, one which would kind of deal with a plan change here, and then a connection from that to be able to then roll that wall over. So it was a kind of a low-budget way of developing this kind of complex form, but one that actually was very economically realistic for the space. So here are two renderings, one which shows the first stage of implementation, and then the second with the development of this open stairwell, and then the kind of media resource elements arrayed along the stair. And then here, an image of that lecture hall, actually minus the seats, it was for an event at this point, and there's another rendering which I didn't bring along, which basically shows it filled with seating, as you can see in the plan, and space for the lecture. This is an exterior view of the space. Inclusion of the AIA graphics. Okay, this is second mission that hopefully will be achieved. This is one of the houses at Sagaponack. It was a project that was initiated by a developer named Coco Brown and Richard Meyer, and I believe Lindy Roy showed her project earlier in the new year. But 32 architects were selected to propose vacation houses, essentially, in Sagaponack and Long Island. There was initially an interest in somehow aspiring to the work that was done on the Wiesenhof Siedlung, but I think that quickly evaporated, and it really became much more about developing each project more or less as, quote, unique art objects. So there was a certain, I suppose, disbelief among the architects. They didn't know how to kind of take that as an imperative. It didn't really bother us. There was a sense, you know, from some that this somehow wasn't real, that to do a project that would be almost a kind of boutique object would somehow have less reality than one which would have a strong kind of social mission like the Siedlung project. Now, of course, we would prefer to do one which would have that, but on the other hand, this project has its own reality, and part of it and part of the kind of idea for us was to use it as a kind of test bed for experimentation, and given its the high profile of the project and the willingness of sponsors to contribute, it became as important to see this develop as a way of experimenting in terms of an architectural mission as much as making this a home. So we were very interested in looking at a way that we could somehow begin to tap into some of the ideas of Mies van der Rohe's early, well, not early houses, but American later American projects, the idea of a freestanding villa, which in some way for Mies would exemplify a very kind of pure development of structure and universal space. We instead wanted to look at a space which would exemplify what we were calling space of ubiquitous difference, that it wouldn't be about somehow dealing with the development of an ideal model and instantiating that ideal model in the landscape, but that rather we would try to immerse ourselves in kind of material and diagrammatic possibilities of dealing with a space that would be continually changing, both in its organizational possibilities and also in its mixing of materials and of inside and outside. So the initial project was to deal with that kind of raised pavilion, and then the task was to somehow try to begin to pull landscape elements into the building and conversely building out into landscape. These are not the column grid. These were actually, for the purposes of the physical model we were making, props. There was actually another thought about having these actually structure the building itself. And because of certain limitations of slope, and these also kind of difficulties in negotiating a fairly simple program of the house, we moved from that kind of freestanding volume model, which you can see the plan here, and in some initial sketches of somehow trying to find a way in which these surfaces would actually begin to structure the space as well as divide them. Moving from that into an idea of being able to kind of take that volume and begin to deal with a region of the volume actually extending down into the landscape itself. So rather than having ramps begin to kind of make connections, that large-scale programming, for example, the swimming pool and also landscape features would actually begin to merge into the back part of the volume. And so in this slide, you begin to get a sense of what we're talking about. The swimming pool then becomes a surface that's then pulled into the lower area of the house, and then a series of three lobes attached to that are developed, both of which are bedroom spaces. And then the volume would emerge as a cantilever over the pool. It's not shown in this image, but then this is the kind of initial series of studies of that, of the structure for this first volume. A land bridge connecting into the extended volume of the living room and dining area. So then these were further studies where we were trying to pull the structure of the building to its periphery, basically deal with a lattice truss along the periphery that actually had changing densities of structure, which would do two things. It would begin to structure the space in a non sort of regular way, but it would also have certain atmospheric effects relative to areas of privacy or openness. So we were trying to sort of work back and forth between kind of physical density of material and have that kind of density also correlate to structural densities. And so this was actually a later development. Unfortunately, it, because of budgetary constraints, couldn't go forward that way. We had to kind of shift to another mode of working. And then here, the development of the various regions of the roof form. This would be the roof of the entry bridge going into the main volume of the living room, kitchen area, and then the connection up to one of the bedroom spaces. So it actually became a fairly complicated knot of surfaces connecting programmatic elements. So this was an intermediate model. It was actually then turned into a series of images also for the publicity of the project, so hence collaging and so forth. But we began to look again at issues similar to the water garden, ways that we could basically begin to develop a striated system that was fairly fine in density, that could then begin to acquire different material conditions depending upon where it was in the building. So for example, where this land bridge comes to ground, there would be the weaving together of earth, grass, and so forth up the ramp. It would then shift its materiality. At this point, it would become mainly cladding, and finally kind of merge into the roof, where that cladding would begin then to open up again, and one would be able to glaze between the linear elements, actually bring kind of create an ambient light through the roof of the space. So that was one of the ambitions of the project, was to see how we could kind of deal with the modulation of a fairly uniform, of a striated condition in the project, and then see how you could continually shift from one material condition to another in the striations. Okay, again, you have the image of the water garden sort of looms over this project as well. Again, in the sketch form here, the issue of trying to deal with paving as it relates both to the inside of the building, the landscape, and then also into the pool volume itself. So I should say, given our practice, we really, in a mainly kind of pragmatic way, will kind of shift back and forth between computer modeling, sketching, physical modeling, and so forth. And it's really a kind of cycle of iterations, whatever would kind of achieve what we want in the most pragmatic way we use. So it's not really so kind of completely centered, say, on computer generation of everything. Here, development of the spa area, which actually occurs below the cantilevered volume and its connection to the pool. And this is a wax model that begins to deal with it. Again, a finer scale of striations, which allows us to develop the geometry of the chaise lounge, the seat, and a bench. And then here, what will be the kind of final issue of structuring this cantilever space, having it basically be supported by the chimney form, keeping the boundary of the top and bottom completely regular, and then having the structure basically billowed down into the space. And then we came up with two possible scenarios for how that structure might work. The first being a grid of structural elements regular to the space. And then the second, which conceptually is more interesting, I think, turning that structure on the bias and then having it run back and be affected by the boundary of the various elements. This reticulated structure then gets compressed in these zones and then opens up like a pantograph in these more open areas. Finally, so it assumes an oblique geometry here and then becomes regular again, both in this space and, say, in this space, this space. As it turns out, of course, budgetarily, this is cheaper. And so this is probably what's going to happen. And so the plans as they stand now, this being an image of the spa, below the level of the main volume of the building, an outdoor connection for barbecuing under the building, actually a kind of outdoor kitchen developed as the project developed, this being all outside, and then also connections down into this and also to the pool. A secondary entrance into the project foyer, a small kind of convertible space for sleeping, a lower bedroom, master bedroom, and then higher up, another bedroom stacked over this zone, the entry bridge, kitchen, and then living area. And you can see in these sections, it was very interesting. Again, kind of force of economy made us focus on certain elements that would be fabricated in a more, say, progressive way. We are talking to the people at CTEC, who I believe are going to be presenting in April, about developing a folded skylight for one region of the central ramped element that goes from landscape up to roof. But then much of the building will be, especially in around the bedroom area, much more conventional construction, wood frame construction. So it's really a whole series of different levels of building as well. It isn't really homogeneously either very crude or very refined, but depending upon where we need to focus for the maximum effect, basically, that's where we're dealing with the budget. Okay, this is the final project I'm showing tonight. It's a competition for the Museum of Art and Technology, which I believe will have, I guess the winner will be announced any day. I mean, sorry, I don't see Neil Denari here because, quite honestly, at least two of the schemes I believe are deeply indebted to Neil. I don't know if people here feel that way, but I would want to make that comment. But in any case, we were very interested in pursuing the project. I mean, aside from the fact that, in a sense, it began to expose the work of a certain generation, and having that kind of focus on a tower in New York, I thought was really fantastic. I was very curious to see what my contemporaries were going to do with this one. We were also very interested because, on the face of it, there's been a kind of division, and this was something that really sort of cropped up at Columbia, between those who would advocate a kind of dematerialized reality for architecture, would want to see the future of architecture somehow move into the area where physicality would cease to be important, and then those who were tremendously invested still in building, and how, in this case, a Museum of Art and Technology, which would deal with, you know, fairly sophisticated forms of representation and video, and well beyond that, and holographic images, like in Greg Lynn's proposal, how that would intersect with what we consider to be still very important, the kind of physical side, the material side of your form. So here, again, just the kind of interesting, also just the hard constraints that nearly everybody followed, dealing with the building envelope and setbacks, and how that really, to a great degree, determined what one could do inside. Site on 21st Street, adjacent to Chelsea Piers and the West Side Highway. And then a proposal for this infill building, the issue of how one would have to deal with a building that, in a sense, would also have to call extreme attention to itself. And so it couldn't be yet another standard infill that would blend in with context, but that rather would have to be kind of balance this sort of necessity, and this is an economic necessity, for having leasable office space as part of it for at least 8 years of its life, and have that then kind of turn over and become fully a Museum of Art and Technology on all fours. So our strategy was this, that basically we would keep the floor slabs fairly regular and conventional. It was more a question of how we would dimension the depths of them, actually, to be able to kind of shift between the uses of leasable office space, which again, in the first 5 years, occupies more than 50% of the structure, and then how that would then, in its final state, would completely become the Museum of Art and Technology, its educational functions, its presentation functions, etc. And so our interest then was to find a way of creating a series of buildings within the building, basically. There would be two sub-buildings, each of which would hang from a superstructure, which was also vertical transportation. There would be two major structural cross elements, the upper one being, you can see that here, a tube that would be kind of split and open, exposed outside, with a large beam that would then, from cables, would have cables hanging from it to suspend this region of the building. And then the second block, the lower element, a closed structural element, a virtual cave, which basically one can occupy the, you know, structural, the main structure and cross element, and it becomes naturally the low light space for the project. So, there was a call for major public space at the street and cafe, a black box theater, and here we disregarded the programmatic brief and sank it below grade, because otherwise we felt just completely, there was a call to actually have it occupy the main floor and push up into this volume. We felt it would just completely block major public flows and events in the space, so we opted for sinking it, raising the floor slightly, doming it slightly, having it then kind of connect to a lower cafe area, and then this space would also double as a space where one could view on this space of